Now starting, all attendees are in listen-only mode.
Well, good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining our part two of our three-part webinar series. This is kind of a early one for us out here on the left coast, and want to give a special thanks to those people signed on out this way. This morning, we'd like to talk a little bit about the advances in pipe jacking and tunneling with the Akkerman Series 2 equipment. I guess I should first off introduce myself. I'm Chris Sivison with Akkerman. I handle the West Coast sales and also support our agents in Europe and South Africa. This morning, I'd like to start off with a brief introduction to Akkerman, for those of you not as familiar with the company, and then follow that up with a, we'd like to then talk about our new enhanced 5000 series pump unit system, and then talk about the our new and updated conventional tunnel boring machines. Also talk about the increased capabilities and enhancements for each product. Quite a few not only performance enhancements but safety enhancements to each product. And then before we get to, at the end, we'll have 15 minutes for questions and answers. Before we get to that, I'd like to talk about the support equipment that's typically used in conjunction with the conventional TBM process. Also, feel free to ask questions throughout the presentation. We do have a panel standing by to answer those questions back in Brownsville, Minnesota. I'm currently out in Seattle. They'll answer any of the questions, and then as maybe a question's asked more than once or whatever, we'll certainly address those at the end. So basically just a quick little recap of Akkerman. Founded in 73, we're really excited, looking forward to celebrating our 40th anniversary this next July. Privately held, family owned and operated company. We pride ourselves with our global sales and service team. We have a wonderful group of agents throughout the world to support that global sales part, as well as each one of the sales staff supports that agent the best they can by visiting that territory 3 to 4 times in a given year. All of our products are manufactured and engineered in the USA. We're also proud to be the only US-based manufacturer of slurry microtunneling equipment. So basically, Akkerman, in a nutshell, provides a full line, full range of trenchless products to install pipe from 4-inch to 168-inch in diameter through 4 distinct product lines. We have the GBM product line, the conventional TBM product line, the slurry microtunneling products, and the ETV machines. In this illustration here, these pictures here, in the lower left is our new offices, if you haven't made it back to our shop in Brownsville, opened in 2010. And the upper picture is the factory on site with the office. Factory was last expanded in 2008. Expansion was necessitated by entering the EPV market and, higher capacity overhead cranes and that goes along with larger diameter machines. Also, the expansion allowed us to have distinct work bays for each product line, which has made our manufacturing process much more efficient. As moving forward here, we want to talk about the 5000 series pump unit system. For those unfamiliar, this is our all-in-one pipe jacking system. Shown in the picture here is the original 5000 with the auxiliary pump mounted to the top. I wanted to point this out because as we go through and talk about the Series 2 unit, the unit introduced last year, that pump has been eliminated. So basically, as we look at the 5000 Series 2 pump unit system, our engineers and the whole entire Akkerman team had to set out some design goals. What is going to make this flagship product better for not only from a manufacturing standpoint, but for the end user. So these are the general guidelines or general goals set forth when we went into building and manufacturing the new machine. One, to offer a better specified machine that equated an increased efficiency. One, to improve the overall ergonomics of the machine. Very important was the compatibility of the machine. It had to be compatible with all existing and previously manufactured Akkerman conventional TBM products. Anytime there's an opportunity in a redesign, you always want to make the machine safer if that's possible. As shown in the last slide, that auxiliary pump was mounted to the top, which increased the clearance of the machine. We wanted to try and integrate that dual feed pump into the machine. We wanted to achieve all this with keeping roughly the same dimensions of the machine. And we also wanted to improve the component availability. I'll go into how we achieve this in a couple slides. And then just the overall aesthetics of the machine we wanted to improve. So with that, these are the enhancements that came from the re-engineering and the manufactured machine. We simplified the overall design of the machine. The machine features two completely independent hydraulic systems, one high pressure, one low pressure. We were able to integrate that dual feed pump while keeping the same height and width dimensions. The overall depth dimension did change by 10 inches, but that was a pretty small price to pay for the added benefits of the machine. Continuing on with some of the additional enhancements, the operator station is much improved. I'll show a close-up picture in a couple of slides. All the essential gauges, all your pressure gauges, and all your essential indicator lights or warning lights are at the operator's eye level, while all the hydraulic controls are now located right at waist or hand level for the operator. We're able to lower the overall noise of the machine under operation using the piston-style hydraulic pumps. Also, like I mentioned a minute ago, we were able to add a lot of safety enhancements and maintenance enhancements to the machine, such as a phase connection error indicator light, also the skid locks as the machine goes up and down the track. I used to call them dogs in the auger bore world, but the locks to lock the machine into the track for your next stroke. There's both lock and unlock lights for that. We've also incorporated two separate hydraulic oil reservoirs right into the build of the machine. Continuing on with the enhancements to the 5000. All the hydraulic plumbing was improved, resulting in fewer leaks and a more efficient layout. The machine is much easier to service. The hydraulic filters, which also have maintenance warning lights on them, are much easier to access than on the original 5000. With the layout of the operator station and all these enhancements, a new operator would be trained much quicker on this unit. And then again, one of the highlights or real key points is with the compatibility of the machine. It works with all existing Akkerman TBMs, haul systems, jacking yokes, and any of the support equipment required. So the overall specifications of the machine. One real important one is the jacking force. That stayed the same, still 400 tons of jacking force. Another great advantage to the 5000 all-in-one jacking system is the versatility. It's able to jack pipes in diameters from 36 to 144 inches in diameter OD. Just basically changing out the jacking yoke. There's not that's what the great versatility of this machine is. And the various products, whether it be steel, Hobos, concrete, polycrete, any of those types of products. As mentioned before in that picture, we were able to lower the clearance. on the machine by eliminating the need for the auxiliary pump, and be able to build that right into the machine without changing the width or height dimensions of the new 5000. One of the outcomes and one of the ways that we did improve component availability was we did reduce the overall, and this also made the machine safer, we did reduce the overall hydraulic pressure of the machine. So therefore, for your IJS cylinders, which I'm going to go in a little bit more in depth with IJS cylinders here in a few minutes, those are only going to be rated at 5,800 PSI now. That was one slight drawback, but that will require the use of either more cylinders or a little larger diameter cylinder to get to your maximum benefit from an IJS joint. In this picture here, you can see the operator station on the left of the updated 5000 Series 2. As I was pointed out earlier, you can see all the critical, there'll be a close-up of this here in a slide as well, but you can see all the critical pressure gauges right at the operator's eye level, all the levers and controls at the hand level, and all your indicator lights are right at eye level as well, or in between eye level and your hand level, right where the operator would be looking. On the right, you can see less aesthetically appealing and less operator-friendly platform. Close-up of the gauges and the warning and indicator lights. You'll note that there's also an empty oil level and low oil level. That way, the operator knows maybe it's a long drive. You've got to have some auxiliary hydraulic things. Here's the operator station. Operator actually using the machine. We'll see another picture of this in a couple slides. You'll note that the operator is now protected on two sides and the base. And from the last picture, you'll see that the operator is also not exposed to nearly as many live hydraulic lines, which would make the machine potentially a little bit more safer. Heaven forbid you have a hydraulic line break. And this slide here with the picture I wanted to have shown, the reason I wanted to show this is because this is a standard 8-foot trench box height-wise with your standard arch spreaders in the 5000 Series 2, being able to clear just a standard box with arch spreader setup, where, as in that very first slide of the 5000 I showed with that auxiliary pump, I believe that added about 28 to 32 inches of overall height to the machine, and obviously that wouldn't have been possible using this pit configuration. In this photo here, this is kind of our kickoff project with the 5000 Series 2 pump unit and the Series 2 TBM, which I'm going to kind of talk about next and go in and talk about the enhancements to the 5000 or to the Series 2 tunnel boring machines. But this project is in Mexico and is going to be this equipment is going to be used together on a series, I think, 6 or 8 250-meter runs, long runs of 86-inch OD concrete pipe. And this slide here, just wanted a quick depiction of the Series 2 TBM, a little bit more aggressive cutter head on this particular machine, but this was shown here at the IQ show in October of 2011, just prior to being shipped to that project in Mexico. Wanted to give you kind of a outside rendition. It does not look all that different from the original TBM. A lot of the improvements were to the interior, to the drive of the new Series 2 TBM. Just want to give, for those listening not as familiar with a tunnel boring machine, just kind of a quick little overview. Sometimes called a wheeled machine. Basically, the TBM is a man entry machine for installing, whether it be concrete or steel pipe or polycrete or hobos pipe, from 48 to 114 inches in diameter OD. laser, you know, standard pipe laser set up at the rear of the jacking pit, shooting forward to a target on the machine where the operator, again, managing machine, where the operator is able to follow that target using the articulated front portion of the shield and steer the machine on the line and grade. It's a very accurate and very accurate way of installing a gravity sewer pipe or like concrete pipe on line and grade. I'm going to go into more of the cutter heads here in a few slides. The material is conveyed from the cutter face, from the face to the back of the machine with a short conveyor inside the machine mounted right in the center of the machine. Here's just a quick little chart kind of outlining maybe the ground conditions where you would use a conventional manned entry TBM with common base sizes. I know I stated before we do have a machine that goes to 114-inch OD in a wheel type machine. Common lengths are, you know, 300 to 1,000 feet. We do have, with the Series 2 TBM and its enhanced capabilities, we do have a few people interested in maybe going like 400 meters, so, you know, 1,300 feet-ish range. Again, just your standard pipe laser is what you're using for steering and guiding. And your minimum shaft dimension is, with this machine, is 22.5 feet. Again, most typically, or at least most of the projects that I've been on, have been in a standard like 40 or 44 foot shaft, so they could push maybe even 2 10 foot sections of concrete pipe at one time. This here is a basic general consideration guideline for selecting a tunnel boring machine versus maybe a slurry microtunneling setup that kind of lays out the differences in the guidance system. And obviously the operation. Your operational cost of a slurry microtunneling setup is going to be much higher with the separation equipment, required, just even the guidance system, manpower, and your support equipment above. Jason Holden is going to be giving a presentation coming in January where he's going to really go in depth and talk a little bit more about each one of these considerations. Maybe there's some projects out there where tunnel boring machines might be a little bit more appropriate than slurry microtunneling, where slurry microtunneling was specified in the past, and it just may make more sense to use a conventional TBM. But Jason's going to talk a lot more about that come January. So when the engineering team looked at and the entire team at Akkerman looked at ways to make the new line of tunnel boring machines better. I need to go back a little bit. Akkerman basically started by building these conventional TBMs, you know, nearly 40 years ago. And so this has been a product that has been in the market for a long time. It's proven. So at this point, it was just, hey, what ways can we make it a little bit better? This is, our flagship product for Akkerman. And so wanted to look at ways to make it better, but not completely, you know, change the world here. We set these design goals. One goal is better drive reliability. One, increase the torque, and that's just because we want to increase the capabilities of the geology to be excavated with the new Series 2 machine. Bidirectional rotation of the cutter head and a variable speed cutter head was necessary. Want to improve the operator ergonomics and really simplify the internal plumbing, the internal hydraulics of the machine to minimize leak points. Also want to improve the overall aesthetics of the machine and make the machine easier to build. So with that came, we're now using a fully sealed and lubricated tri-roller bearing. Not only better drive reliability, but the ability to withstand a little more torque. Now using a little bit of a higher pressure motor to produce the higher torque, that equates to the Series 2 TBM having 40% more torque than the first series. Now that's based on, for example, the 720 TBM having six motors, comparing apples to apples, 40% more. We do offer like an HD model with 9 motors, and that would increase the torque another about 60% from there. So we simplified the hydraulic system and the internal plumbing. Therefore, that was where the fewer leaks come in. Improved the overall ergonomics of the machine for the operator. I'll show a couple pictures of the inside of the machine here in a couple slides. But the operator, all the controls are right at head level. The also an e-stop right over the right shoulder of the operator. And then from all this, when integrating all of these improvements, the result was a much more robust machine, which is going to be needed for the expanded range of geology we'd like to excavate with this machine. And also the increased distances, as I mentioned, we have one particular customer interested in going 400 meters with a conventional TBM setup. And so the overall construction machine is definitely much more robust. There's a couple views of the interior of that particular 720 TBM. You'll see on the left the operator seat and the controls well labeled and laid out right above his head. You'll see the emergency stop for the TBM right over his right shoulder. And then on the picture on the right, you'll see where the nine motors are located there. And then you also see the articulation point. So I wanted to point that out for maybe people who haven't seen the inside of a conventional TBM. On the very, very lower right corner, almost where the little A is sticking in, you'll see the articulation cylinders. There's a set located there, equal on the left side, and then another set on the top to steer the machine in any direction. So with the Series 2 machine, we're going to offer a little bit wider range of cutter heads with the increased torque capabilities and the increased geology that we feel the machine has the ability to excavate. Still going to offer a standard dirt cutter head. We're going to have a carbide bullet bit cutter bar for, you know, real soft rocks or real firm soils. The stationary sand shelves. And of note, those first three, those are interchangeable throughout the tunnel, even, you know, obviously stopping tunneling, but in the tunnel, in the hole, you can change those out. The next couple of cutter heads would obviously be mounted at the start of the tunnel without the ability to change it. The closed face cutter head attachment for wet or unstable soils, I think a few people listening have experience with this cutter head. It's got three hydraulic doors that the operator sitting in the machine is able to open and close to maintain how much flow is coming. If you got into a real, real unstable ground, you could close the doors to limit the material that's able to come through the cutter face. Also going to offer a mixed ground cutter head, almost like a combination of disc cutters and carbide cutter bits, similar to maybe like a microtunneling rock cutter head that has both styles of cutters on it. Again, that will be used for a mixed face condition, maybe a weathered rock, a soft rock, a medium, you know, 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 PSI, maybe rock, something like that. Nothing over the top hard. Okay. Well, now I'd like to just kind of talk a little bit about the support equipment that goes along when using a conventional TBM setup. You're going to use you're going to have a way to get the muck from the back of the TBM to the shaft, and then also talk a little bit about IJSs and then the various jacking yokes available for this machine. The 524 haul system shown here on this slide, very well known, very versatile machine. Typically used on tunnels less than 60 inch in diameter. Obviously, you could use it on larger diameter tunnels, but your efficiency goes way down because you can only move so much material with this little 5 horsepower machine. Does have a very easy to remove battery pack, switch out batteries on site, minimize your your downtime. There's not a long charging time there or anything like that. And basically the haul unit, you can adapt several different size, I'd say probably six different size muck buckets right to the frame to maximize your efficiency of spill removal from the tunnel. On larger diameter tunnels, this is the newest designed product, also debuted, I believe, at the IQ show. I know it was at IQ in 2011. I think that was about when it was brand new. 15 horsepower motor, so obviously much faster, 750 feet per minute. Larger diameter tunnels accommodates either the standard muck bucket or the XL muck bucket. And I think one of the great features of this unit is that its versatility as far as track width. Maybe you already own 20-gauge track or own 24-gauge track, or maybe you do various size tunnels. This will work on both size gauges of track, which is very nice. Also has another unique feature where it has a regenerative braking system where while under braking, the battery system charges. Just another great built-in feature to this unit. The jacking yoke, for those unfamiliar, this goes between the 5,000 pump unit system and your jacking pipe, offers 360-degree jacking force point to eliminate point loading on the on your jacking pipe. And again, standard sizes are sitting on the ground, but obviously with all the different product pipes out there and all the different types of pipe, whether it be concrete or Hobox or steel or polycrete, your ODs and IDs could be slightly different. And we customize these jacking yokes for that, size specific to your project. A little bit about intermediate jacking stations. These are, you know, typically used in 150 to 300 foot intervals throughout a tunnel. The distance apart is going to be dictated by potentially diameter, the type of ground you're tunneling through, your jacking load, your jacking force for one of these is you're going to have 300 to 400 tons of jacking force per jacking station. We've seen a lot more cases just even this year where right in the contract documents it specified, hey, you need to have three of these on site, or you need to use two of these within this tunnel alignment, whether you're going to charge them or not, or you think you need them or not. And so just want to make everyone aware of the IJS and the importance of those. Get you out of cheap insurance, get you out of a lot of trouble. Just a quick little note here on the service and support at Akkerman. Obviously, we're committed to exceeding customer expectations in every way possible, but I wanted to make a note that not only the aftermarket sales team, which just does a wonderful job of keeping the equipment, your equipment running, but the field technical support team is really, really dedicated to making sure your project's successful. They have a can-do attitude. Recently on a project in California, had a little bit of a issue with integrating a old series microtunneling container with one of our new slurry TBMs. Alex in particular was on the phone with the customer and was able to troubleshoot that problem right from Brownsdale and get them up and running right away. And just these guys just do a fabulous job, and they're really dedicated to the projects. With that, I'd like to take time for some questions here. But I'd also like to invite you all back on January 9th for part 3 of our webinar series. Jason's going to give a talk about slurry microtunneling, when and where to use it, and all the necessary considerations on a project that determine whether to use slurry microtunneling system or conventional TBM. I'd like to thank all of you for listening this morning and your interest in our products. And I want to wish everyone a happy holiday and a prosperous 2013. We'll now open it up for questions for the next 15 to 20 minutes. Got to wait for some questions to Okay, I had a question come across asking about the mixed ground cutter head. Sorry, at this time I do not have a picture of that, but it'd be very, very similar to microtunneling mixed ground cutter head. I could send you a picture of that. It's going to be a similar design, maybe not quite as robust, but it'd be a very similar design to that. I'm reading this question here. I guess I'm not fully understanding it. The cutter head itself is bidirectional. I would have to defer to, I think we have Brad standing by to answer this question a little bit better. He can answer it through the chat or answer it, and I can answer it verbally to everybody here. But does the new TBM have the ability to move the inner drub forward or reverse? I'll have to get back to that person on that question. The next question came in was, how long does it typically take to change out a dirt cutter bar to sand shelves? Again, I don't have a specific time frame on that. Speaking with another member of the sales team over the last couple of days, I would imagine that this would be a time when you'd be down for, I would think, 2 to 3 hours. This would be a switch out in the tunnel. You do have to remove the conveyor to interchange any of those cutter heads, so there would be a little bit of time involved there. The next question in was, what diameters do we currently have available in the Series 2 TBM? Currently, we've built the 720. The rest of the machines are designed and kind of waiting for, obviously, the North American market here has been a little bit quiet, as many of you know. And as the market improves a little bit, we'll go ahead and continue to add different sizes to inventory. But they are all engineered and designed and ready to be built. There was a question I'll get back to here in just 1 second as far as life expectancy. The maximum distance between receiving and exit bits on a conventional TBM, you know, most typically these are used in roughly maximum 1,000-foot runs. As I stated before, we do have a little bit interesting going 400 meters, which would be like 1,300 feet. Obviously, at that point, we're going to be incorporating some IJSs into the system. And so you're really going to be limited by the your product pipe. Your concrete pipe can only withstand, say, 800 tons of force. And so at that point, you're not going to be going much further than, say, 1,000 feet. I mean, I haven't heard of too many conventional TBM projects that have gone more than 1,000 feet in these diameters. I had a question here on the corrosion protection options for the IJSs. I would have to defer to our engineering department and get back to whoever asked that question. I'm sure we're noting who's asking these questions, and we'd be more than happy to get back to you through an email or a phone call as soon as possible on that. Okay, I had a question regarding the diameter of the, what diameter is the 720? The 720 machine is used for 72-inch ID, 86-inch or 87.5-inch, depending on if you're using B or C wall concrete pipe, OD. The largest diameter of this machine will be the 960 machine, which would be the 114-inch OD machine. Had a question a couple minutes ago about the life expectancy of the drive gear. Again, whoever asked that question, or we can get it back to having that, I'd have to defer to our engineer, and I'd be more than happy to get back to this person in an email format. The corrosion resistance on the IJSs, we could always, in the past, what we've done is changed out to stainless steel components, and that's certainly changed out the can to stainless steel. Done this in the past, but that would be one of your corrosion protection options at this time. As far as simplifying the hydraulic system, I would again defer to our engineer. I get back to you on that. But I know that one of the ways that things the system was less leak inducive and things like that is through lowering the overall PSI of the whole system down to 6,000 from I believe it was 94, 9800 in the past. And so that there, we increased our component availability. We were able to use a little bit better components, and we simplified the leaks that way. As far as specifics, I would have, if you wanted a rendering of the plumbing layout or something like that, I could defer to our engineer we also have used a manifest based system instead of a bazillion hoses, so that was another way we simplified the hydraulic system. Had a next question come across had to deal with the larger, would we be willing to use manufacture larger diameter wheel machines. At this time, we've only engineered up to the 960 machine. I would imagine that it would certainly be a good consideration to maybe go to a little bit larger design with this new setup. But at this time, we've only designed up to the 960 size machine. So let me see what the next questions are here. Yes, all the machines are compatible with one another, so you would be able to use the old 5000 to operate the new TBM. For those of you who asked a couple of questions that I wasn't able to answer entirely, I'll be more than happy to get back to you via email. I'm sure, like I say, we have your name. Laura has your name, and she'll shoot me an email, and I'll get back to everyone individually, or can certainly post these answers in a little bit better form for you. Thank you very much for attending. That appears to be all the questions we have right now. And again, look forward to seeing and hearing everyone back here on January 9th for Jason's presentation regarding slurry microtunneling and when and where to use it. Have a great day. Also, we're going to be posting the presentation to YouTube. If there's some other employees that you'd like to see this, or people out on the West Coast that it's 6:30 in the morning weren't up yet to see this, we post on YouTube and also accessible through our website as well. So have a great day, and happy holiday and a happy new year.